Good morning, First Baptist of Bayshore. I am Brother James Smith, the Sunday School Assistant Superintendent, and I would like to say hello, good morning, hallelujah. This is Sunday the 31st, the fifth Sunday of May. It is Pentecost Sunday. So God bless you. Again, I do miss you, all of the students, all of the Sunday School students. I will be glad when we can come together and have Sunday school here in the sanctuary. I do miss you. I do miss cutting up and acting up. You know, I like to laugh and joke when we teach, and I do miss that. Right now, I'm relegated to right here. This is about as far as I can move. So I do miss walking around and reading and talking with you, and I look forward to that time when we can all come together and study the Word of God together. Our recitation, 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, we love you and we thank you. We bless you for yet another day of opportunity, another day of possibilities, another day of potential. Father, I pray that we would live this day on purpose, that we would live it deliberately, that we would live it intentionally, that we would not live it haphazardly. You said in your word to walk worthy of Christ. So, Father, let us walk through this lesson, walk through your word, walk out this faith, work out our soul salvation in fear and trembling. We do pray that it would be worthy of Christ. We do not want to take the blood of Christ and trample it underfoot, as your word says in Hebrews. So, Father, just use me for your honor and for your glory. Speak to me and through me. I pray that even though we are studying at a distance, that we would all come together and be on one accord. Holy Spirit, this is your day. Have your way. In Jesus' name, amen. Today, the lesson is the King's eternal throne. The King's eternal throne. And for a song, the lesson recommends, in the hymn book, if you have one with you, hymn number 4. I am not the one to try to sing this on my own, so I think what we will do is just kind of read the verses. Come thou, almighty King. Come thou, almighty King. Help us thy name to sing. Help us to praise. Father all glorious, or all victorious, come and reign over us, Ancient of Days. Let's jump to verse 3. Come, Holy Comforter, thy sacred witness bear in this glad hour. Thou who almighty art, now rule every heart, and ne'er from us depart, Spirit of power. Amen. If you have a birthday on this past week or this upcoming week, happy birthday to you. Again, we do have some gifts for you in this cart here. When we can all come and study the Word of God together, Elder Edmonds and I will dole out the goodies. Before we jump into the lesson, by way of housekeeping, this is the last lesson in this textbook, we are aware. I spoke with Elder Edmonds about a week ago and asked, you know, are we going to order new books? And if so, how would we get them to you, the students? Whether or not we would receive them and have the students, you know, maybe come and meet us in the parking lot, we do not know. He said, for right now, we will not order the new books because we're trying to decide if we're going to remain with this this program or utilize a new one. But if you go into the back of your text, I believe, let me put my glasses on so I can see what I'm saying, about page 188, topics for next quarter, topics for next quarter. And we will be in Judges, 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel in the upcoming quarter. So the page 188 toward the back of your textbook, it will give us the lesson title, the corresponding scripture per week for the next quarter. Pray on it. Prayerfully, we will have new texts and we will figure out a way to get them into your hands. Prayerfully, we will be able to come back and start studying together at a distance, you know, remaining socially distant. We do need to be obedient. So let us get into this lesson. And it is the King's eternal throne. And I will read. And this is coming from, for you, those of you that do not have a textbook, Psalm 45, Psalm 45. And it reads, my heart is inditing a good matter. I speak of things which I have made touching the king. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. Thou art fairer than the children of men. Grace is poured into thy lips. Therefore, God hath blessed thee forever. Gird thy sword upon thy thigh, O most mighty, with thy glory and thy majesty, and in thy majesty ride prosperously because of truth and meekness and righteousness, and thy right hand shall teach thee terrible things. Thine arrows are sharp in the heart of the king's enemies, whereby the people fall under thee. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. Therefore, God, thy God, hath appointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. All thy garments smell of myrrh and aloes and cassia out of the ivory palaces, whereby they have made thee glad. King's daughters were among the honorable women. Upon the right hand did stand the queen in gold of Ophir. Hearken, O daughters, and consider, and incline thine ear. Forget also thine own people and thy father's house. So shall the king greatly desire thy beauty, for he is thy Lord, and worship thou him. And the daughter of Tyre shall be there with a gift. Even the rich among the people shall entreat thy favor. The king's daughter is all glorious within. Her clothing is of wrought gold. She shall be brought unto the king in raiment of needlework. The virgins, her companions that follow her, shall be brought unto thee. With gladness and rejoicing shall they be brought in, or shall they be brought. They shall enter into the king's palace. Instead of thy fathers shall be thy children, whom thou mayest make princes in all the earth. I will make thy name to be remembered in all generations. Therefore shall the people praise thee forever and ever. Psalm 45, 1 through 17. So as we enter this lesson, let's establish the context, and I will try to not be before you long. I won't be long-winded. This is what they call a messianic psalm. If you recall, this entire text, the lessons, it was a messianic prophecy, unit one, unit two, the promised savior, unit three, the eternal king. Let's just review just very quickly. Messianic prophecy, the coming one, this Messiah, the Mashiach, the Christ, will be a prophet like Moses. As in Numbers it said, the bronze serpent on the pole, look and live. And Jesus said, if I be lifted up, just as that serpent was lifted up, look and live. So the Messiah will be a prophet like Moses. The Messiah, look and live to the Messiah. The Messiah will be a son of David. The Messiah will be a priest like Melchizedek. Then unit two, the promised savior. This Messiah will be a suffering servant. This Messiah will be the lowly king. The Messiah, the one that is promised, this promised savior, the one revealed in scripture. That was Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. The Messiah will have victory of the Lord's anointed will be had by this Messiah. And the Messiah will also be the chief cornerstone. And that the last unit, the Messiah will be the righteous branch, will be one king over all of all Israel, will unite the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. This will be some of the duties of this Messiah. The Messiah will be a light for the Gentiles. The Messiah will be the Redeemer, is the Redeemer that will come. And then this last lesson, the King's eternal throne. So that just by way of review. So this last lesson, the King's eternal throne. Now, what do we see in this text? Verse 1. Well, we have four points, bullet points in this lesson, if you want to outline this lesson. The King's eternal throne. Verse 1, the writer. Verses 2 through 9, the king. Verses 10 through 15, the king's bride. Verses 16 and 17, the king's children. So that will be the outline for this lesson. The writer, the king's bride, the king's children. Verse 1. The writer. My heart is inditing a good matter. My heart is overflowing a good matter. I speak of things which I have made touching the king. I'm going to talk to you about some stuff that I said about the king. This writer, we do not know who this writer is. We do not make the assumption that it is David. We do not know when it was written. It is, the lesson says, and it is believed that, the Psalms are sung. You would sing the Psalms. The Psalms are kind of like old blues or country western, if that's your thing. You would sing the Psalms, you know, if your heart was low, you know, just like an old blues song. David, who wrote most of them, you know, he experienced many things in his life. And so some psalms are psalms of ascent. When you're on your way up to worship and you're ascending up to Jerusalem, up to the temple, you know, it's more of an upbeat psalm. They're called psalms of ascent. Then, you know, there are messianic psalms that deal with, you know, they're prophetic about who this Messiah will be. There are other different types of psalms, but they categorize them in, I think, about five different types. I had mentioned it once in the lesson before. So we do not know when this psalm was written. We do not know the author of this psalm. It is believed that this king that this writer is talking about, it could be a earthly king. Perhaps, you know, for argument's sake, for example, it could be about Solomon. And this is a psalm that would have been sung at the king's wedding if it is about an earthly king. Is it? Let's take a look at some of these verses. There are a couple of verses in here that jump out that say to me, it's not about an earthly king, it is about the Messiah. So verse 1, kind of like the inscription, my heart is overflowing a good matter. I'm just bursting at the seam talking about my king. That's this writer's position. That's his sentiment. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. I'm ready to tell you some stuff. I'm ready to write down some stuff that I feel about this king. So the writer's aspect, that's what this is. This lesson calls this a maskil, a psalm of enlightenment or instruction. It may be a reference to the worship leader in the temple who would have led the singers. And there are some things in the superscription, you know, when you look in your Bible, a psalm of David, a psalm of this person, you know, Moses wrote a few. I think Abraham has one, you know. And so before verse 1, there are some notations like Salah. We don't actually say Salah when you're reading it. Salah is just it's an indication that whoever is singing to take a pause. So when we're reading the scripture, we see Salah, we don't say Salah, we just pause for a minute because, again, these psalms were sung. So verse 1, it's just basically the writer saying, you know, this psalm is going to be about, it's a psalm of instruction about a king, whether it is a earthly king or the Messiah, you know, if it's prophetic. Verse 2, let's jump down. Point number 2, the king. So now we're going to find out some things about this king that this writer is speaking of. Is it important? Is it relevant? Let's see. Thou art fairer than the children of men. Grace is poured up into thy lips. Therefore, God hath blessed thee forever. So for this second point, the king, there are a couple of things. The king, the fair and graceful king, the warrior king, the divine king, and the king's wedding. In the next few verses, that's what we will see. So it says, you are fairer. Now we know if this is a natural, an earthly king that he's talking about. Oh, king, you are handsome. You know, you got a little something going on. You are fairer than all these other folk. We know that other scripture prophecy says, you know, you are not comely. You know, you're not anything that anybody should desire. So he's saying, well, hey, you know, you're very fair. Well, does that mean he's fair in his appearance, in his looks? Or maybe he's fairer internally. Who is it? I believe the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in his I Have a Dream speech, he says, you know, I long for a day when, I'm paraphrasing, when my children will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. So maybe he's saying the content of this Messiah, you know, the content or the character content of this king, of this Messiah, is fair, you know? Not that he is handsome outwardly in his appearance, but internal, his character is fairer than everybody else. You are fairer than the children of men. Grace is poured into thy lips. We know if this is about Jesus, if this is about the Messiah, the Christ, the anointed one, the one smeared with the Holy Spirit, not just smeared with oil, because a king had to be anointed. You know, the priest would anoint, or a prophet could anoint a king. So he was anointed with the oil. The Messiah is anointed with the Holy Spirit, if you will, for lack of a better term, smeared with the presence of the Holy Spirit. Grace is poured into thy lips. We know that Jesus spoke very graciously. You know, they said, you know, we went to go and, you know, arrest this guy, harass this guy, but he spoke like no one else. He spoke as one with authority. And they were awestruck when they heard him speak. Said, well, you know, are you going to become one of his disciples as well? Man, nobody ever spoke like this guy. Grace was in his lips. Jesus is the one who has fulfilled that. Has there been a king that has fulfilled that? Maybe. But grace was in his lips. No one has spoken like this man. Gird thy sword upon thy thigh. Now we're getting into that warrior aspect of this king. This king will be fair, handsome, graceful. Handsome, or the content of his character, will be very fair, desirable. So he will be fair and graceful. Now the warrior king. This king is coming to take care of some business, not to be a pushover. Yes, he will be the lowly king, the humble king, the meek king, riding on a donkey, all of these things. But he says here, gird thy sword upon thy thigh, O most mighty, with thy glory and thy majesty. And in thy majesty ride prosperously. In thy majesty ride victoriously. In thy majesty ride as someone who is accomplishing. You know, accomplishing an endeavor, someone who is overcoming, someone who is enduring, someone who is conquering, a victor. He's the fair and graceful king. He is the warrior king. He's coming with his sword. Gird thy sword upon thy thigh, O most mighty. Verse 4, and in thy majesty ride prosperously because of truth and meekness and righteousness. And thy right hand shall teach thee terrible things. We know that Jesus came, well, he is righteous. And to be righteous means to do what is right, to do what is fair, to do what is balanced, to do what is equitable to all parties involved. That is what righteousness, that's how it translates. That is what it means. And Jesus went about doing good. He was righteous. He is righteous. He spoke the truth. You know, you can be, something can be true, but to be the truth, you know, the definitive aspect of what true is or what truth is, that is, that Jesus is the embodiment of that. But let's go on. Thine arrows are sharp in the heart of the king's enemies. Okay, the king's enemies have been struck with his arrows. He's not coming to be a pushover. He is the warrior king. And so what is this, a psalm that is sung at an earthly king's wedding? You know, overflowing with good tidings and just, you know, showering this individual with praise. Has a king fulfilled these things yet? Well, let's keep on looking. Thy throne, O God, is forever. Now let's stop right there. Thy throne, O God. Now, is he still talking about this earthly king, or is he talking about a Messiah? Because is he calling this king God? Because you jump from verse 4 where you're talking about this king to now, verse 3, 4, 5. Now we get into verse 6. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Thy throne, O God. There has not been a king that has been God. And no good Jewish person is going to call an earthly person king, an earthly king God, you know, that's blasphemy for them. So it's not about an earthly king. It must be prophetic about someone who is to come. Because at this point in time, in the context of this scripture here, you had Saul had been a king, David, Solomon, and then there was Rehoboam, Jeroboam, and the kingdom split. Now, is this about maybe Solomon? Is this about, you know, after the kingdom split? We don't know. But nevertheless, there had not been a king that anyone would call God. But here he's saying, your throne, O God. So he must be talking about the Messiah, the Christ. FYI, you know, Jesus Christ. It's not his first name and his last name. It's Jesus the Christ. So the Christ is the anointed one, is the Messiah, is the one that Moses said, one like me will come after me. Way back when in the Old Testament, Moses had said that, you know, he's going to be a prophet like me. So thy throne, O God, is forever. He's talking about it, it is prophetic. Ooh, and I have to move on. I'm getting behind. I don't have a whole lot of time left. So let me jump forward. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. Therefore God thy God, or therefore God thy God hath anointed thee. Again, it's confirmation. It's a double confirmation. He's calling him God, so it must be the Messiah. Then he's saying, God, your God, God, you know, Messiah, Christ, Son, your God, Father, Holy Spirit, has anointed thee. This is a messianic, it is about the Messiah, about the Christ, about the Mashiach, about the anointed one, the one smeared. This is a messianic psalm. It is not a psalm about an earthly king. So knowing that, we know that the king is fair and graceful, that this king is a warrior king, this king is divine because he called him God. And then we get into the king's wedding. Let's jump into the king's bride. In the Old Testament, God referred to Israel as Yahweh's bride. New Testament, the bride, the church, is Christ's bride. So if we, knowing that, if we apply what these next few verses, if we apply to the church as opposed to just a bride, let's see what it says. What can we learn? How can it apply to us? Hearken, O daughter, and consider, incline thy ear, forget also thine own people. This is verse 10. And thy father's house. Listen, church, bride, congregation. Incline your ear. Make sure that you listen actively, intentionally. Don't listen passively. Deliberately listen, ponder, consider. Forget the old stuff. Forget your father's house, the stuff that you used to do. Leave that there. Now it's all about you and this husband, you and this Messiah, you and this Christ, you and this Messiah King, whose throne is forever. So shall the king greatly desire thy beauty, for he is thy Lord. The king will desire the church's beauty. This Messiah King will, he will desire the church's beauty. He is, the Messiah King is the church's Lord, the bride's Lord, us. He is our Lord. And then it talks about the daughter of Tyre. Those are people that are not Jews, pagans. They will come into the fold. They will come and worship Christ. We know that if you read your scriptures, you know. Jesus came for the Jews and the Gentiles, those that are non-Jews, those that are saved and those that are not saved. He came to save all. But let's just jump forward because I really didn't mean to spend so much time. I don't want to get behind. So the bride is the church. Today, that is how we would apply it. The children of the bride, or the children of this union, do, you know, a double or twofold application. we are the children of God, and of course, you know, the church is the bride. So you can either refer to yourself as the bride or the children. And what are our responsibilities and what are our obligations? The children, or the king's children, instead of thy father shall be thy children, whom thou mayest make as princes. We will be princes. I will make thy name to be remembered. So let's just back up. The king's eternal throne. David had made, it's called the Davidic covenant. David had made a covenant with God, or God made a covenant with David. Let me be clear. Back in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 12 through 16, you know, David, you wanted to build me a house. Yeah, but you're not going to do it. In fact, I'm going to build you a house, meaning I'm going to build you a legacy. And one of your bloodline will be on the throne forever. Now we know the kings, you know, they came, they lived, they died. But he's saying that there will always be someone from the tribe of Judah who will be a king from now on. Well, Jesus, the resurrected Christ, lives forevermore. He came, he fulfilled all that had been prophesied of him. So he is that Messiah king. And now he lives forever. So he can be in that position with that title. And not just king, he is priest, prophet, and king. Priest, prophet, and king, just like Melchizedek. From now on, for all eternity. His throne is forever, as the scripture says. I don't want to cut this lesson so short, but read this. The eternal throne. I just want to, in this last 2 or 3 minutes, just because it is Pentecost Sunday. This is not part of the lesson. I was a little, I don't want to say concerned, perturbed that the textbook did not even mention Pentecost Sunday. Now, there are some denominations in the household of faith that really acknowledge Pentecost Sunday. Pentecost Sunday, in the book of Acts, you know, that is when the Holy Spirit, the presence of the Holy Spirit came in, you know, the tongues of fire on everyone's head, and everybody started speaking in other tongues, and people received the Holy Spirit. Pentecost Sunday, which stems from an Old Testament festival. You know, there were, in Exodus, he says, you know, there are like three festivals that you have to come to. You know, of course, well, there's the Passover feast, or the Passover meal. There was the Feast of Weeks, which is the precursor to Pentecost. After the Passover, and, you know, they were in the wilderness, and, you know, you'll see it in Exodus, you'll see it touched on in Leviticus, and I believe in Deuteronomy, I forget what chapter, but, you know, he elaborates a little bit more. After the harvest in the spring, after the harvest of the rye, then you would have the harvest of the wheat. So after, it says, when you put the sickle to the wheat, then 50 days after, 7 Sabbaths, and then that next day would be the Feast of Weeks, 7 weeks. So when in the New Testament, after the resurrection, 50 days later, the people were there because, you know, they were already there being, you know, good and obedient Jews, already there honoring the Passover, because you have to take your pilgrimage and go to the temple for Passover. So they were already there. So rather than have them go there and then go back home and then turn around and make another pilgrimage back for the Feast of Weeks, they were there and they stayed. I was doing a little studying. I'm like, okay, but I understand the 50 days, that's when the Holy Spirit came. But why did the Holy Spirit have to come in those 50 days? Is there anything in the Old Testament that, you know, that indicates why that is? Pentecost was just, you know, an outgrowth of the week's Feast of Weeks. So I didn't find that answer yet. So, you know, perhaps you can, you know, call, email, text, blog, whatever, with the pastor or Elder Edmonds and ask that question. I don't have that answer yet. You know, we know how it came to be. But there was something that Jesus, it said when you put the sickle to the wheat in the Old Testament, that was in Deuteronomy, Jesus said, you know, if a grain of wheat falls, it dies by itself. But, you know, if it dies, it bears much fruit. I forget exactly how he says it, but I'm like, okay, well, when the sickle cuts down the wheat, then 50 days after, you would have this celebration. Well, Jesus was cut down. 50 days later, the Holy Spirit comes. Now, is that the answer? I don't know. But I would say spend some time and study, you know, at your leisure. So it is just about time for me to wrap this up. I apologize for cutting the initial lesson short, but I was told to kind of be finished, you know, about 5 after the hour, so, you know, to keep it to roughly about 35 minutes. So I'm being obedient to Brother Obadiah. The King's eternal throne, Jesus is the King forevermore, from now on. Pentecost Sunday, enjoy yourself on this day. Do a little studying. You know, we treat the Holy Spirit as the odd child out, you know. Learn about the Holy Spirit, who the Holy Spirit is, and what the Holy Spirit is here to do to understand your relationship with the God that is within you. So as we prepare to pray out, read the lesson. Going forward for next week, see the lessons in the back of the textbook. Yeah, maybe that's why I was late. I was doing that. I was doing the housekeeping. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Next week will be Judges chapter 3, Ehud defeats Moab. So our next few lessons will be coming out of the book of Judges. Go ahead and read the book of Judges to get familiar with it. And again, the last page, 188 in your textbook, to find out going forward. And if we do purchase new textbooks, we will let you know, or make an announcement, have the pastor make an announcement on Sunday or Thursday or something to let you know what's what and how to get them. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you for the indwelling presence of your Holy Spirit. We pray that we would be sensitive to your Spirit, not grieving your Spirit, not quenching your Spirit, but that we would be led by your Spirit in all things. As we remain in our homes, or as we venture out and we are returning back to work, Father, the world is in chaos. People are getting killed just for the color of their skin. We need the presence of your Holy Spirit. We have to have God with us, because greater is he that is within us. So we need your Holy Spirit within us, leading us, guiding us, showing us how to overcome, showing us how to be conquerors. You said you have come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. So, Father, we want to have that abundant life. We do not want deficient life. We do not want life that is less than, but we want the abundant life, life that is more than enough in quantity, more than enough in quality. Love us, bless us, keep us until we can all worship and study together again under one roof. In Jesus' name, I love you, I thank you, we all praise you, Father. Amen, amen, amen.
Somebody lift your voice and just worship. Just lift your voice and worship. Your voice and worship. Oh, the Spirit of God is moving on those who worship. Somebody just wave those hands. Just honor your presence tonight, Holy Spirit. That's all we really want, Lord, is just to be where you are. Just to be in your presence.